that none should perish has been the battle cry of Assembly of God missions for almost 100 years. That cry has motivated literally tens of thousands of men and women to answer God's call to go and tell in the farthest reaches of the earth. I believe that Jesus is coming again soon, and urgency is beginning to grip the heart of a new generation to abandon it all, to follow the call of Christ to go and tell those who have never heard. God is raising up new ministries that are having a tremendous impact around the world. Ministries like Live Dead, where you're seeing young men and women abandon all to go into some of the most difficult places in the world, into the Muslim world, to share the message of Jesus Christ. Apostolos, another that is seeing teams planted on university campuses all over the world to be able to witness of the power of Jesus Christ to students who are traveling from countries that we're not able to get into. Another such ministry is one that's found here in Bakersfield, based right here in our own hometown. Mission 111 is seeing young men, young women, adults of all ages, not just trained, but sent out into some of the farthest places in the world to go and to tell the message of Jesus to people who have never heard. Okay, well, joining me to talk about her experience with Mission 111 is my friend Janaea Lair. Janaea, nice to see you.
Nice to see you.
Boy, you're just back from a very big experience with missions.
Crazy experience, yeah.
You've only been back how long now?
About a month, yeah.
Well, then I need to ask you, why Mission 111 and what does Mission 111 do?
You know, Mission 111 is a missions school that is 3 months, and you go in the fall and in the spring, and their purpose and their vision is to see unreached and unengaged people groups come to Christ. And so they search out these unengaged and unreached people groups, and they send people out as a gospel army to reach them. And because that is Mission 111's DNA, I knew I had to go. I knew I had to be a part of this movement that they're starting.
Well, then I need to ask you, where did you go? What did you do? Did they just drop you somewhere, or was there some preparation?
Well, the first 6 weeks of this program, you have training. So you're taking classes and you have physical training, and you go on local outreaches to prepare yourself spiritually and learn as much as you can before you go.
Okay.
And then the next 6 weeks, you're in Ethiopia, and they have planned out the tribe that you're going to go to, but sometimes that plan doesn't always work out.
So now, wait a second. The tribe that you go to, you talked about unengaged or unreached people. Were you actually going to a tribe that had never heard the message of Jesus?
Yes.
Well, then you also tell me right here that sometimes it doesn't work. What's a little bit of that story?
Well, this last fall, they were trying to go to the tribe of Mercy. And you have to get permission from the federal government and the permission from the local government, and then you have to go in and ask the chief for permission to bring a team in to present the gospel.
Okay.
And that doesn't always work out. And so this last fall, the government actually said that if you try to fly in via helicopter, we're going to shoot your helicopter down, and whoever survives is going to go to jail.
We'll probably make your mom and dad real happy to hear that news, too. Okay.
Yeah, so. But this spring, actually, we were going to try and go again to the Mercy tribe, and we're getting all ready and so excited about going and finally going to reach them. And then it comes again where we don't have one more letter or one more permission, and you know, there's something else going wrong. There's always something that's going to try and stop you from doing the Lord's work. And it came to the point where it was better for us to maintain the relationships that we had with these people than to try to go in again behind their backs. So they prepared for us, the Malé tribe, and they had translators all set for us, and we were excited to go. And we were sure that, you know, if this is the place God's going to call us, He's going to get us there and He's going to show up.
So now, what did you do when you got there? Now, did they know, they knew you were coming?
Yes.
So when you got there, was there like a 5-star resort somewhere around there that you all stayed
no,
at?
No, there wasn't.
So
it was actually quite a crazy experience getting in. There's a town called Jinca, right? where we go, and then right around there is where a lot of the tribes are outside of this little town. Well, as we're about to leave to go to this tribe of Malé, we're thinking we're going to have some kind of Isuzu, like kind of a bigger truck, right, or some kind to get all of our day packs, all absolutely of our food bags, yeah, and all of our day packs, and then 12 of us there because of the driver, and then we had our translators, and then we had two other church leaders that were going to come with us.
Okay.
Well, they pull up in a little Toyota Land Cruiser, a
just
little
one
truck,
Toyota
just one,
Land Cruiser.
Just one, and so we packed up our bags with a tarp over it, and then we had three people sitting in the front, two people on top of the car, of and course the rest of us hanging on the side, standing up, trying to keep the people who are sitting on top of the truck not falling off, and there's no road exactly to get there. And so this was a 3-hour travel without a road. So we're just kind of finding our way, driving through rivers and weird terrain, just crazy dirt roads and whatever you think of when you think of safari, that's what it was.
So this is just raw, real Ethiopia.
That's what it was.
And what was your reception when you got to the tribe?
You know, it was, first of all, it was hot. I mean, it was, I know this is
Bakersfield.
Yes.
Oh my.
Yes.
Yes.
And, you know, at first we were hearing of, we pulled up to actually a church, a hut that was supposed to be a church, and we were confused. We were, you know, why is there a church? This is supposed to be unreached, unengaged, and, you know, what's going on, you know? Mm-hmm. And, you know, we later found out that the people that we went with, the church that sent us off,
right,
3 years ago, they built this hut in faith that a missionary was going to come.
So before someone ever got there, just as an act of faith, they built a hut that would be a house of worship, with no missionary there, no congregation yet, just the hope that this would happen.
Yep.
Wow. Well, I want to ask you, because I've heard a little bit, and I'm sure that people can kind of decide that this was kind of roughing it for three weeks completely.
It was, yes.
A lot of hot showers, a lot of whatever. Oh,
no.
Not at all. Not
nope,
at all.
None of that.
Well, I, having been some places in the world myself, you know, usually there's one of those moments or two that kind of really make an imprint on you. Could you just tell me, I've given you a little time to think about this one, but what was that moment that really has stayed with you during your time among them?
Yeah. You know, actually 3 years ago, there was a man from the Malé tribe. He actually went outside of the town to get educated, and he came back and built a school with his hands and mud, and it was just a hut that he wanted to start a school that now holds over 100 kids that are or that are being educated, and it's up to 3 grades, and there's 3 teachers, and you know, they're all Christians now and all of that. Well, we were able to go to the school every day and tell these kids these stories, the God story. And the most impactful moment for me was when it came to decision day. We're asking the kids who wants a relationship with God, and almost every single kid raised their hand and prayed and received God as their savior and have a relationship with him now, and now have teachers every single day where they're going to school and they're going to have a godly influence.
So now these people had no credible witness of Jesus before you all came there?
To the Malé tribe, you see, what happened was we were hearing talk about a previous missionary, and we were confused. We weren't sure, is this, you know, again, is this unreached or what have you? But about a generation ago, a missionary had come and went to maybe a couple villages out of the entire tribe.
Okay.
And so there was few that believed, and then the missionaries left, abandoned them, and had no discipleship, no connection with them for a long time. So
after a period of time as well, then that would mean that some of that initial passion or fervor would have gone away because there's no one to keep that going.
Well, not only that, the previous chief, the chief's now's father, tried to put a curse on the land that whoever came in, whether which religion, whatever, tried to change the tribe, that they would be driven out. So Muslims came and all these people tried to come, and they were all driven out even Protestants came in and tried to drive him out. But you know what? This new chief, after his father died, tried to break this curse, and we were the very first people who were able to come in and spread the gospel. And there were people who had never heard Jesus before. And then there was actually one particular witch doctor that we went to, and she, as we were telling her these stories, she said, "I remember my father telling me these stories and telling me," she said, "I forgot all about it. After he died when I was really young, he told me to follow these stories, but I didn't. And now I know that God loves me because he sent people from a faraway land to remind me of these stories that my dad once told me."
That is just incredible.
You know, and so there were people who didn't believe, and there were people who had a recollection, but they still didn't know. And every day that we taught these stories, they always told us, come back or have someone teach us these stories. Right. And so our translators that came with us have actually recently been able to go back and you know, tell them more stories and disciple them, which is amazing, because they not only need to hear the gospel, they need to be discipled as well.
Absolutely. I need to ask you a question, because, you know, we send young people, young men and women, on missions trips locally and overseas, and we have for many years.
Yeah.
How has this trip fundamentally changed you?
This trip not only changed me forever, you know, that seems a little bit cliche, but it always does, you know.
Sure.
And ever since I was a little girl, I've wanted to be a missionary, and this trip just confirmed that, wholeheartedly confirmed that this is what I'm supposed to do for the rest of my life. And, you know, I got a taste of what it's like to be a missionary without anything, without, you know, contact from home or anything like that. It was, you know, truly rough, and it truly just preaching the gospel, and that's it. And, you know, as I'm home, you know, I have a different perspective on the way that I live, and the way that, you know, the world works and how God works. And it's crazy to see God's hand and seeing his hand even as I'm home. So this trip was allowed me to open my eyes to that and to really confirm this is it, you know.
Well, then what would you say to a young adult that might feel some tug in their heart toward missions? What would you say to them after this experience?
You know, I say, if you feel a tug, if you're a student or even if you're an adult, we had a 7-year-old man have his birthday on our trip. So however old you are or young you are, if you're feeling that tug, I want to tell you that if you feel it, go, because there's never going to be a perfect time. Satan's always going to try to stop you from doing the Lord's work. And so the time is now. If you're feeling that, don't hide it or don't try to put it away. Go. There's this opportunity before you. I think you should go.
Wonderful. And so tell us a little bit about what your future is going to hold.
You know, actually, I'm going to be able to go back in the fall as a leader and lead a trip there. So Mission 111 is starting schools now outside of just Bakersfield. They're having opportunities to start in San Francisco, in Orange County, and they're actually going to try schools in Sweden and all these different places. So God's really opening up the doors for Mission 111. And so whatever that holds, whatever God has for me in that area, I'm in it for the long run. So I'm not exactly sure what, you know, the rest of my life looks like, but my next step is being a leader. And, you know, God's plans are bigger than I could ever imagine, or more wonderful than, you know, anything I could ever think up. But you know what? I want to be a part of his plan. I want to be a part of who he is and what he's doing for the kingdom of God.
There's no better place to be.
No better place.
Right where God wants you to be. Janaea, thank you very much for being with me today.
Thank you.
I want to be on your team as far as this fall is concerned.
Yeah.
Maybe not going to Ethiopia, but I'll help you get there.
Thank you.
Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Maybe God is speaking to your heart today. Friend, God doesn't want anyone to perish, but they will. If they don't have someone go and tell them about the wonderful story of God, the love that he expressed through Jesus Christ, and give them an opportunity to place their faith and their hope in him.
Will that person be you? It can be. And I would encourage you to take up that call that has motivated thousands over these many, many decades. We go that none would perish.